Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
We have the tools, we have talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is going to hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward, how much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you got to be willing to take the hits. And not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane. Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
All right, welcome everybody. Your eyes do not deceive you. It is 1 p.m. Eastern over here. I know usually we go live at 9 o'clock and it's nighttime and all that, but it's 1 o'clock. Early show today. Welcome to Comic Book Radio. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. This is episode 160, and today my guest is Anna Folkenstahl. She's got a book called Ghost Story, or GH-057 Story. And we're going to be talking about independent sci-fi and fantasy. Before I get started, before I bring her on, I want to say hello to those of you in the chat. Oh, even before that, actually, let me get this out of the way. Alterna's latest campaign, we're almost 60% funded. There's 20 days left. Go to alternacomics.com/funding. We also have the campaign on Indiegogo. We are 113 away from $2,000 on Indiegogo, and the campaign is just above the $4,000 mark out of the $7,000 goal. So that funds four new comics: Blood Realm number 14, Horace H. Hoover number 3, Unit 44 number 9 and 10. So go check that out. Give the campaign a look and your support. Spread the word, all that good stuff. Time is a ticking. All right, so let me say hello to you guys. We got Jason in the house. What's up, Jason? Says, looks like I finally get to catch one of these live. Well, thank you for being here, Jason. I'm glad you could catch one of these live. Jaden One, what's up? Thank you for being here as well. Good afternoon to you. We got Passmaster Dan talking about coffee, cup of coffee in the big time. Yeah. How's it going, Passmaster? Cole King is here, too. What's up, Cole? I'm glad to have you and see you here on this afternoon. We also got Brian Suddenly Old in the house. Is work going to catch the replay? The comics that she makes are really good. Got volumes 1 and 2. Well, there you go. If you guys want to check them out, the link is in the description of the show. Spaceman, coming on down from above. And it is daytime out tonight, Spaceman, so I hope you found your way, and I'm glad that you're here. Good to see you. Red Centric is in the house, too. What's up, Red Centric? Andy Gogo says, Pete is always working. Well, who isn't, right? Everyone's always working. It's like people that are like, oh, man, I think they're hurting for money, that kind of a thing. I'm always thinking when someone says that, who isn't hurting for money? I'd like to know this individual who's just like, money? I don't really need any of that. I'm fine just without it. You know, keep at it. do what you want to do. I like doing this. I like talking to creators. And it works out because 1 o'clock today, I don't have a show tonight. 1 o'clock today works for Anna because she's over in Europe. So everything's good. Shane's not going to say good morning because it's not morning over there. See? It works for everybody right now. Andy Gogo says, Pete's the Nick Cage of CG. I guess I'll accept that for now, depending on what you mean. Yeah, always working. Bills don't stop. There you go. All right. So, without further ado, let's bring on the woman of the hour. We got her right here, ready to go, Ms. Anna Folkenstahl. What's up, Anna?
Hello, everyone. Hello, Hello. Peter. Thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you for being here. You beat me to it.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to have you here. I'm looking forward to the conversation today. Now, I know that you've got a comic going on right now called Ghost, right? That's how you you say it, Ghost Story.
Yeah.
I have to wonder, because we had a comic years ago at Alterna called Cluster F asterisk CK. So
okay.
Cluster F-bomb, right? Now that made it very difficult for people to look up this title. Has it been difficult for you? What was the, I got to think it's not that easy for people to find it. What was the methodology there in naming the title?
Yeah, well, the story was, it just went along and I was like, yeah, let's check for a logo. Let's check for a name. What do we do? And then I had, I think maybe a couple of weeks to figure out everything, and then I was just like, yeah, Ghost Story, it's fine. So yeah,
very nice. All right, well, yeah, so if you guys want to check it out, it looks great. It looks like a really fun comic. I like the art on it. I got a couple questions for you, but before we start with those questions, I want to know what got you into comics. What put you down this path?
I actually started with reading manga when I was 12 or so, 11, and I really loved the art. I started with Sailor Moon, I think it was, and I always loved to read it, and I also am an artist myself, but I'm not that great at drawing manga, and I did my own manga as well, but that's where I stopped, so I'm just not that skilled like other people. And I had a major art blog, and then I started something else. I started to make props, so it's more like crafting. But I always liked manga and everything, and I kind of had my own stories, but I knew my skills aren't that great, so I thought I might get a real artist who can draw things for me.
Oh, who's your artist? What's the name of this?
I'll probably butcher his name, but I call him Tien. So yeah, you can find him actually. I don't know if any Vietnamese people can read this here. So this is his name.
I'm not going to try. I understand.
Yeah.
So yeah. Very good art. Very good art. I'm noticing that there's a difference. So you got, it looks like issues 1 and 2 are colored. But there, I also see black and white pages there, and then on 3, I see black and white. How's the color scheme?
Yeah, actually, I have a couple of pages that are colored, and then it starts to get black and white.
Oh, okay.
I do it with all of them. I just have a couple of pages that I think fit the coloring, and then I start to get black and white. It's also
I like
much cheaper than... Yeah, I like the manga style.
Yeah, I really enjoy the black and white on the book. Very nice. So as far as this goes with this story, what was the inspiration for it? How'd you come up with it?
Oh, God. That's, I think, a blur as well, like with the logo. So I had this...
The woman of mystery.
Not really, no.
Unknown, even to her.
Unknown. No, I actually had to make a costume for a convention. I was a judge. And I had to go on stage and everything. And I was like, yeah, I don't know what to do. So I made a costume. And it was actually, it looked a little bit like this. And people had no idea what it was. So I was like inventing a backstory for this character. and suddenly he was male and he was a robot, and I was, yeah, that's how it started. So the whole backstory.
You were just winging it at a convention?
No. At the convention, I had no idea to answer to people. So I was like, yeah, well, his name is Ghost, I think. And then okay. I had to somehow invent. That was obviously months later that I came up with everything.
So you just jumped off the cliff and built the parachute on the way down, is what you're telling me.
Basically, yeah, I'm still still doing it. Still winging everything.
That's interesting. How'd you flesh out the story then past that? If that's the origin and that's how you conceived it, how'd you start fleshing out the rest of the story?
So my costume or character had this battery in his, you can actually see it here, part of it. So yeah, that's his battery here. And I thought, well, what could we do with this? Okay, he needs batteries to survive. It's his heart, basically. And that's how I started to weave the story. I was like, okay, he has to get the resources somehow. What do we have to do with this? Do he has other people? Is he in a group? Does his group need this battery? And that's, yeah, somehow it all started.
And what's the main objective in the story? What's the conflict?
Well, the first book is actually about the resources. So he has to get this resource called Carbalt because his people can't mine it anymore on their planet. And so he's looking for it with other Tressians. So that's their name, Tressians. And yeah, that's the whole first book is about finding it and fending off the bad guys too. And that's one. It's actually just the story finished here, but I then decided to actually go further and add to it. So you can read book one, you'd be like, yeah, okay, that's finished now. But then I go on book two and he goes back and actually has to deliver things. And yeah, the bad guys are even bigger than before. So yeah.
What are the bad guys like? Can you explain one of them?
The bad guys are actually also Tressians. So they're from the same species, but they are the bad guys, basically. They're assassins, and things happen that made the assassins to turn on each other, and they're basically killing Ghost and the other, or trying to kill them for resources.
So are these artificial life forms entirely, or are they part organic?
Yeah, they are robots, you can say. So human-sized robots.
It's a species of robots.
Yeah.
Do they kind of create and build their offspring?
They were created and built, but they are actually only here to, let's say, serve. I have these Tressians called Great Heroes. They are blue and they look like this. And a couple of them, of course, they are numbered. Ghost is number 57. And we have a couple of more. So he's basically the great hero species of them. So they serve, they help people.
Is that what the GH means? The great hero?
Yeah.
Ah,
yeah, and we have the Grim Reapers. They are GR and they have also numbers, and they are the bad guys. So they have a whole backstory, but this will appear in book 3. Yeah.
Very nice. So, well, I guess Ghost is lucky that his numbers work out so that it could sound like Ghost.
Pretty much. He was very lucky.
We have a couple of those. Yeah. If he was like GH, I guess he could be like GH 157. He'd be like, gist. Get the gist of the story.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Why not?
This is hard.
But Ghost is much, much cooler, actually.
Yes,
so, yeah.
Absolutely. So coming up with this story, there's a lot of sci-fi. You describe it as sci-fi fantasy. Now, you've got a human character in there, too. Where does she play into this? How does that come along?
Well, she was just in an accident with Ghost when he was on his way to looking for the resources. And she was on her own way to another planet, when they met and they had to figure out how she would go to her planet because there was a couple of problems, and Ghost had to figure out his own problems because the ship was damaged and everything. So yeah, they had to team up at some point to resolve a couple of their problems. So yeah.
Now, is she in a predicament that is unfortunate or dire?
What do you mean?
Is she in a bad place? Is she the someone after her? Is she trying to get away from something or someone? Or is she trying to find something or someone?
In book one, no, she's actually just trying to get from one planet to another. Because she lost someone and she wanted to start a new life. That's her story.
Okay.
And this will be for book one. But of course, she will stay in book two and three. So yeah, she will get into a lot of trouble along the way.
So it's interesting that you have that dynamic between them. Is there kind of like that human-robot dynamic? Are they going to sort of play off of each other in that respect?
Absolutely. He's more reserved. Ghost is more reserved and loyal and everything. He likes to have things sorted out. She's more the naive type and very impulsive and So that's a good chemistry, I would say.
So as far as sci-fi and fantasy goes, things like that, what got you interested in that genre?
Sci-fi and fantasy. I think it started with the Orville.
It started with the Orville.
Be interested in sci-fi, yeah.
Wow.
I mean, I did watch Star Trek and Star Wars and everything. That was a little bit older, of course. But it wasn't like I didn't really have the passion to go there. It was usually fantasy, everything revolved around fantasy, but then like somehow something like just snapped and I was like, yeah, sci-fi, that's nice. So
what
yeah,
was it
I,
about
I can't
the Orville that kicked it off for you, that made you feel an affinity?
Well, actually the robots, I mean Isaac. So okay. I was like, well, I kind of like these kinds of robots. And that's also a part of the influence that I had in my sci-fi. I wanted to have these robots and these inhuman-like species to just see how this works with human and what they do, and just to have this really sci-fi, sci-fi influence overall.
Very nice. Now, in terms of fantasy, what kind of fantasy has inspired and influenced you?
I'd say, do you mean movies or games?
Anything.
Because usually,
anything. Yeah.
Anything.
Movies,
so,
comics, games, books, whatever.
Well, the biggest influence after my art blog was Skyrim, actually. So The Elder Scrolls V, Skyrim. So this was a major, major life point in my life that I was deciding to start to be a prop maker and do all the crafting, and that was the fantasy part of my life.
What is it that you're coming up with?
Well, you would have to go to my website to see everything.
Got,
I can't.
You got nothing around? Can you describe some of it, maybe? What it is that you do?
I have this one, maybe, but this is not Skyrim related. This is just a figure that I made for it was the last campaign, I think.
Very nice.
So this little ghost figurine.
Wow, how'd you make that?
I sculpted this and made silicone molds out of it, out of each part.
Wow.
So let's say I.
Oh my lord! You just ripped his arm off right in front of us.
No, no problem. No.
The humanity.
He's addressing anyways. It can be fixed, so no problem. So yeah, I just basically sculpt the parts by hand. I don't 3D print anything, so yeah, that's all sculpted by hand. That's my policy, I would say. And then I make silicone molds of them, so negative forms, and then I pour the resin in to have multiple pieces of each. So yeah, that's...
Wow. Have you done other figures or statues like that?
This is actually the first one that I did. I started a couple of others, but this is the first one that I thought would be the best one for my campaign. So I have a couple of other figurines, but they're not that great. So yeah.
Well, I'm sure they're better than what I could do.
No problem.
So you sculpt these out? Have you always been sculpting? How long have you been doing that?
Yeah, like I said, I was always an artist since I was a kid, and when I was I stopped to draw, and then I just went into sculpting and crafting, and I figured out that I'm not that bad at it, so why not continue with it? And that's how my prop making career started.
Nice. What kind of props have you made for yourself or for someone else?
Oh, I made a couple of those. I have to show because it's different to explain. So.
Sure. Yeah. Let's see it.
This is one of them.
Hold on. So I'm gonna make it full screen here.
Well, that's one of them. So basically,
oh, man.
fantasy weapons, I have sci-fi weapons as well. So from the Orville, I did one of the guns, one of the that they have.
That's great.
What else do we have? Oh God, we have. Helmet.
Holy
there we go.
There so we how go. Do you make these?
Oh God, there is so much dust on here. Oh God, no problem. should dust this off a little bit. Yeah, great. Well, we have different, as prop makers, you always have to be prepared or just be aware what materials you can have or what you can do. So you can have like, you can work with wood, you can work with clay, with foam, EVA foam. You have such a great range that you just have to try out what's best for you. This is some epoxy sculpt that's actually, so it's basically clay that hardens after 24 hours.
Wow. And you make that from start to finish? You paint it up and everything too? Wow.
Yeah. I sculpt it from scratch and then paint it. In the end.
That's awesome. Man.
Thanks.
Yeah, no problem. Passmaster has a link here to your props and replicas, and you take commissions?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I take commissions as well. I currently have one commission, one small commission. I take commissions, but it's like I look at it and I'm like, okay, I would love to do it. And when I'm not interested, I'm like, I don't know.
How much is it that you would sell something like the axe or whatever for?
I usually don't sell these big pieces. They are just one. They're just so unique. I don't really sell the unique pieces, but I do have the props that I sell in my online store, so you can just look at them there. They're regularly made, so yeah. I always have
Very
them.
Nice. How much was the statue that you were selling?
That small ghost.
Yeah.
This was with the campaign, so I'm not selling this on the page really.
I mean, like how much was it for? How much did you sell it for?
Oh God, I don't know. I'd have to look at the campaign. It was in a bundle, I think, but I don't know how much I asked for it. But yeah, it was basically the bundle with the figure.
And do you have a campaign currently live now? Where can they go? Can they go to the site to buy the book?
Yeah, you could go to my website, so gabelockstudio.com.
Very nice.
But I do have a campaign in the works now on Fund My Comic, so I'm working on it.
You have one currently live, or you're setting it up?
I think it's visible, but it's actually not done yet. So I don't know why it's visible, but Yeah, it's in the works, and it will be, I think, online on Valentine's Day.
Oh, so, yeah. Very soon. Okay, wonderful.
Very soon.
You have like a sign-up page or something for people to go to?
Well, I only have my newsletter, but I didn't really see one on Fund My Comic.
Okay.
It's completely new to me.
Let's see. So yeah, this is the website. So you have a newsletter on there, you said, right? So people can go here and they can sign up and they'll get notified when you launch.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, you guys can go to this site right here and sign up. Good stuff. All right, we got a couple questions. I got still some more questions for you. You're not leaving anytime soon.
No problem.
But we've got questions in the chat.
My evening is free.
All right. Let's see here. So we got one question here from Comics for Life. It says, when choosing your artist, did you look for someone with a similar art style to an artist you're a fan of?
The boss of that studio. So basically he's an artist who's working in an artist studio, and he can't talk English, sadly. It's and I had to, so I had a couple of pages from different artists, and he was one of my favorites, and I was like, yeah, I would love to choose him because I like the style and everything. It fits my taste. So yeah, that's how I chose him.
Oh, okay. How did you find the studio that he works for?
I found a studio on Fiverr, but they actually have a page now, so it's Light Comic Studio in Vietnam.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah,
okay.
they're great, and I think they're getting much bigger now and more popular, so yeah.
Very nice. So when you coordinate your script to get turned into the art, how does that work out?
You mean when I have to give the script to my artist?
Yeah.
Everything. Basically I have the script ready after the editors and everyone who needs to read it. So I give it to the studio and they usually translate it for Tien, for the artist. Then he's sketching page by page after, and I see the progress. So he has a Google Drive, I think, and then I can just check whenever I want and see what he did. So yeah,
very nice, man. Interesting process. Comics for Life has another question again. It says, do you give your artist a copy of your models to assist as reference?
You mean the model of
I wonder
of the
if
costume, I think, or?
I guess so, yeah. I mean, are they coming up with the concept visually? How is the visual concept of it established?
They made a character sheet for each character, so that their reference actually. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Very nice.
I did have a couple of pictures of the costume that I did, but they made the character sheets, and I was like, okay, fine. That's great.
So they based it off of that costume that you had?
Yeah. You can find the costume actually on my page, Falkenstahl, as well. I think in the gallery, if you scroll down, you can see it somewhere. I don't think you can miss it.
Very nice. All right. Let's see here. Spaceman wants to know, where are you from? Where are you reporting from right now? I know you're over in Europe.
Yeah, I'm from Switzerland, from the northern part of Switzerland.
Very nice. Does that mean that the book is shipping from there, or is the book shipping from somewhere else?
No, this is the first campaign actually that I'll ship from the US, so it will be much cheaper for you guys. So yeah.
So you got somebody else handling fulfillment for you?
Yeah, definitely. I don't know if I can say names here, but
Is it like a company or is it an individual?
Yeah, it's a company.
It's a company. Very nice. All right. And yeah, if you guys got the book at all, or the volume one or volume two, let me know. You know, let us know that you got it. Let us know what you thought of it. If you liked it, you know, let us know that. That's it. It looks good to me. It looks pretty good. Let's see. We got Comics for Life asking another. Oh, there's Passmaster. See, he says, do you make models of characters other than yours, like King Cryptid? Wink, wink.
What's the joke?
Wants to know if you'd make a model of characters that aren't yours, like mine, King Cryptid.
Oh, I could, obviously. Yeah, I could.
Yeah, that would be, if you're not familiar at all with King Cryptid, first of all, shame on you. And then second of all,
I've
that's okay.
I've seen it somewhere.
And then third of all, yeah, that's what he looks like. So, yeah. But yeah, that would be kind of cool. I was thinking something along the same lines, and but you know, we got time. You're a very busy person, and so am I, and whatnot. But you know, maybe one day.
We're sadly all busy, but
yeah. Let's see. Michael says, "I thought I recognized the accent. My grandmother was Swiss." Well, there you go.
Oh,
very nice. All right, so. Now for the nitty gritty. This is the dark part of the conversation. Don't be scared.
It's dark enough in here, so.
Well, then it's fitting. So in terms of what you've been doing as an independent creator, what are some of the struggles? What are some of the things that you've had to deal with and overcome? And maybe you're still in the midst of trying to overcome. What are some of those things?
Oh yeah, oh god, yeah, it's everything. So, but basically it's promotion, marketing, growing the audience, everything that you have to do to get more eyes on the product. But I mean, I know how to produce the product with my artist, so we're like a team now. I know everything, how he works, how I work, but the biggest problem is still the audience. And yeah, promotion, marketing, so I'm so bad at it.
What are you trying? What are you doing? And also, Red Centric says that they got both, and the shipping was very well done. Both the books and the figurine arrived in excellent condition. So there you go, guys. Purchase with confidence.
Thank you.
So what are you doing in terms of marketing and promotion? What are you finding specifically that you're having struggles with?
Yeah, so posting on social media and making nice web banners and quotes and text isn't working. So I try to get my hands on a couple of marketing books. I tried them, I read them all, but it's not working for me. I'm, I guess, too stupid. Or, I don't know, unteachable. No. No, I don't know. I seriously don't know. I tried the books and I was like, okay, I don't. So the next was watching YouTube videos, and I was like, yeah, okay, let's try it, and it's not working for me, so...
Do you have a YouTube channel?
I have one, yeah, but it's, okay. You can find, I think, live streams on there, where when I was crafting, you find product videos of my props, but nothing really that engages the audience. So yeah, promotion on different groups like Facebook, Reddit didn't work because they hate it. When you self-promote, they're like, nope, you can go. So I'm like, okay, not there.
Set up an account and then say, I saw this really cool book. And then post and be like, I'm not self-promoting, I'm promoting someone else's book. Would they be mad at that, you think?
No, I should really try that. I'm just noting this down.
I'm
teachable.
You know.
A liar.
Yeah, this is
fake
this
account.
Unfortunate.
On Reddit. There we go.
And then be like, hey, I heard about this really cool book, you guys. You gotta check it out. And then it's not self promotion, it's just regular promotion.
It's true. Yeah,
oh,
sadly,
world.
I'm. it's the easiest things I know.
It's a silly thing because it's so easily overcome. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like it's just so silly. I love seeing self-promotion, if anything. Now, I don't like seeing self-promotion that feels either pushy or taking advantage. And what I mean by that, and I'm not saying that you do this whatsoever, I'm just saying, well, I don't like seeing. And what I mean by pushy is when it's just about buy the thing, buy it, just get it, right? Okay. And it's like, yeah. I don't know what this is. What is it, you know? And then I don't like seeing when people feel like they're taking advantage. They just don't care, which is dropping the link and then running away. You know, every now and then I'll put something on Twitter to, you know, promote your project and the replies and this and that, you know, let people know what it's about and where to get it. And a lot of the time, there's a lot of people that do the right thing, I think, which is to talk about the project and then provide a link and all of that. But there's people who always will go in there and then just put a link and that's it.
Yeah.
And it's like, this is your opportunity. Make the most of it as much as you can. This is an opportunity to tell people something about the book in some kind of a way or whatever it is you might be selling. Don't just put the link there and then just think that, oh, it's so brilliant. It looks so good, whatever that is, and they'll click on it just because it's there. You know, and I don't like seeing that. But in terms of self-promotion, I love seeing people who are excited about their stuff. I never understand that when people think, well, if we allow that, then everyone's going to come in and talk about it. So who cares who comes in and talks about all their stuff? That's great. We need to see more of that. That should be encouraged. But, you know, unfortunately, in many places, they don't like seeing that.
Yeah, I always try to, when I make a post, I try to think of something new that maybe the reader didn't see. I know I have literally zero people that watch this, but I'm like, okay, how can I make something interesting without spoiling the whole book? But this isn't really easy as well. So without spoilers, how to get people to...
Yeah, well, I mean, when it comes to spoilers, think of it as, and this comes being a storyteller, comes with the territory of, you can talk about almost everything other than, of course, what's a surprise, what's a reveal, you know, and you'll know as a, or you should know as a storyteller, what that kind of stuff is. You know, what's that moment where the creator in the book is going to set up a scene or a moment that's going to be this big, like, oh man, wow. I didn't see that coming, or whatever it may be. And that's a spoiler.
Yeah.
And that diminishes the fun of the book. But anything else, if you talk about the character, if you talk about the setting, if you talk about the premise, the setup, you know, the stakes involved, I think that part of it is great. And some people like to be very secretive about it, and I hate that, because they go, oh, well, they'll find out when they read it. And I go, well, what's going to make them read it? Well, the way it looks. And the way it looks, you know, sometimes that you got to have something that really speaks to someone. The way it looks, that's it. I'm going to get it. You know, and then all the sound of it. Oh, the title or the plot, the breakdown, the pitch. Maybe again. But if you can really describe the characters, what they're doing, why they're doing it, you know, the old adage, who, what, where, when, why. And if you can give a how, it's going to happen, you know, even better. But again, just kind of draw back a bit on what is the fun. What is the moment that you don't want to ruin for people? So they know the character and they get into the story and then they're like, oh yeah, that's such a cool moment. I didn't, you know, but if you reveal it when you're talking about it, you remove it, you take away that fun. Mm-hmm. But everything else I think is always up for grabs because that's the thing that you're going to learn. You're going to learn about the story and then you're going to become more invested in wanting to see how does that play out. But there's a lot of creators that they go, no, I just want them to read everything. Here's a very basic pitch about what it is. And then a lot of people go, oh, I don't really know enough about this to get hooked.
Well, partially I can see why, because I also had a couple of things in my second book that I didn't want to spoil. But I announced book three. I was like, well, I somehow had to tie this up because in book two, it's like important. And then we have this in book three, it's connected, but it's hard to not spoil, but also to have, I don't know, it's really hard to find a balance here.
Each story continues upon the one that came before. Is that how it is?
Yeah, it's actually, it will be five books in total. So we are at the third book and now it's ramping up. So, yeah.
All right. So, yeah, so it's a 5-book series. Is there anything planned past the 5th book?
It really depends on the studio, but we will see how the series does. If it does great, hopefully I can bring them to bring the artists to do more. If not, then yeah, we have the complete arc there.
Very nice. Comics for Life is asking, how big are comic books in Switzerland? Is it a tough market to break into? And which countries do you find acceptance for your work?
We have the European market, and I have no idea how this is. Usually when I'm at the comic book store, they have a lot of manga. So it's basically manga, manga, manga. And you have the thick French books or really European. You also have US comics, but it's really a tiny part of the comic book store. And breaking into it, it's in Switzerland, I would say no. You have to go international. So US market is, I think, the best one.
Is that where most of your readers seem to be, in the US?
I would say yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, online definitely. I have a couple. I always have 2 conventions per year in Switzerland, and I also sell my books there. But it's 50-50. A lot of people in Switzerland, but I think because they know me, they're there, they're at the booth, they're like, okay, let's buy this, and the rest is online. But yeah, that's usually international.
I do have to say, I have to be brutally blunt here, but these are words of love. I do have to say that based on my own experiences, when we had a title that was very difficult to look up properly, and we've had 2 or 3 of those over the 18 years, it always impacted sales and the ability to find it. Okay. And at the time, I would kind of try to say, look, you should have a title that's easy for people to remember, easy for them to spell, and easy for them to just look up based on when they hear it. Now, we had a book called The 12, but it was spelled DXII. And so if you looked up The 12, you'd find something different. You would never find, and you would go, what is this book? But we have to list it as the X and then the letters II.
Yeah,
we couldn't do X and 1-1. We couldn't do So with the Roman numerals as it is, it looks kind of nice, but it made it very difficult to look up. Mm-hmm. And then that other book, the one I was talking about, the Cluster F asterisk CK. Yeah. Book, aside from the issues of the title and it wouldn't be accepted in certain stores because of it, like Barnes and Noble wouldn't carry it. At the time, anyway. Aside from that, it made it very difficult for people to find the book, and also difficult to share it on social media, because people would put and it wasn't an asterisk, actually. It was a hashtag. It was a pound sign. So that made it even worse. So when people would type cluster, the F hashtag C, K. So it'd be
That's harder, yeah.
Exactly, yeah. Okay. So I don't know if there's a way... If you could consider leaving it the way it is, but having that as a subtitle and having a main title be something else that people can find, whatever you wanted to call it. So it would be, I don't know, you wouldn't name it this. This is horrible. But like space fantasy. And then the subtitle would be ghost story, the way you have it spelt out and things like that. So people could look up whatever that main title is and then find it. Because most people, it's going to be difficult for them to remember GH-057. And as you, when you say it, when you talk about it, you don't go GH-057. When you're talking about it, you're saying ghost story. So it's going to be difficult for people. Now, that's just 18 years of seeing how this stuff works with a lot of things and making my own mistakes with it, too. So I don't know if there's a way for you to consider at any point in time, maybe after the 5th book or whatever, or even during the course of it, if you wanted to kind of switch up how you market it at the very least, maybe not even change it on the book, but at least type it out, market it different so people could find it, look it up really easy. That's something to consider too. And I know it feels like we shouldn't have to do that in this day and age, right? To tailor it towards looking it up on a search engine. But that's unfortunately, or maybe even fortunately sometimes, the world that we live in. So that might help you out. As far as the other things go, I'm very curious to see what other kind of strategies or things that you've done, because I find this is a conversation that many creators have. I'm always very curious about it, to learn new ways to get out there, because there's always things that I find that, oh, wow, I'm not doing that. That's interesting. They're doing that and it's working for them. For you, what are some of the things that have worked for you? And also, what are some of the things you found that you tried it and it just, it really didn't seem to resonate?
So what worked was actually just taking some advertising money and just pay those Meta folks with some money, and that worked. But I don't have endless money. Even if I'm Swiss, I am not rich. So yeah.
Is that a thing? Is that a stereotype that? Swiss,
yeah,
Swiss,
I think a lot of people think that, oh, Switzerland,
banks.
Yeah, where they have they all have money, but I'm not one of those, I don't know, 1%. So I'm just a regular person.
Okay. Well, I mean, depending who you ask, I'm American, I'm not horrible. But depending who you ask, maybe I am. I've never heard that before, Swiss people having a stereotype.
Oh, really? Okay.
For having money. That's interesting. Maybe that's just among, like, Swiss people.
No, it's really, I have a couple of American friends, one of them was like, oh, Swiss people, oh, yeah, of course you have.
I just, I think of cheese and chocolate and watches and
that's
banks.
That's much better.
I think, yeah, especially the chocolate.
Banks.
I think of that. I enjoy that. And the beautiful architecture and the scenery. I love the mountainous views and everything.
Mountains,
it's beautiful,
yeah.
Beautiful looking country.
But if you ever try something from Switzerland, do try the Zweifel chips. They are the best chips in the whole world. I swear, I had all the chips in the world, but those are the best.
What was the brand again? I gotta write that down.
It's Zweifel.
Okay.
Zweifel. They are usually the paprika orange. You should have those.
Very nice. All right, I'm gonna look that up, and I'll be on the on the lookout, because there's a couple stores in the area that they do imports.
Oh, okay.
And maybe they have it. I'll take a look.
Maybe.
All right. Interesting. But yeah, so what was it for the promotion marketing side of it that you found that you tried, but it really just didn't work out whatsoever?
Marketing books, Facebook groups, then growing the audience. So I always read about you should grow the audience, and I was like, yeah, but how? So teaching was something that was in there, like teaching people how to write or anything else. And I was like, nope, I'm not a teacher. I'm sorry, but I would probably write BS, so don't learn from me. So there are better people out there. And teaching. Could I teach them about astronomy? Not really, because I'm not great at that. I love it. I love astronomy and space and everything. But if someone asks me, can you explain me why there is a full moon and sometimes there's not? And I'm like, I know why, but I can't explain it to you. I'm sorry. So, and also we have entertainment, I think it's one of the points, but I'm not great at entertaining people online. So there we have it. That's the social, the growing your audience part.
Well, I always think that it's best when people lean into what they are into and confident about in a genuine way. And what I mean by that is, it doesn't matter if you're out there and you think, if I talk about this certain subject that I have to be an authority on it or an expert or whatever. You have to have, I think, a genuine curiosity about it and an interest. And I think, you know, if you have an openness about you that you're willing to share that with others, I think people gravitate towards that, because most experts and authorities are only that way for a brief moment in time anyway. Most of what they talk about in an expert kind of way is usually disproven or built upon later, or changes completely in a year, 5 years, you know, whatever it may be, sometimes a day. So if you have a whatever subject you're interested in and you want to talk about it, if you're really interested in astronomy or you're interested in anything whatsoever, anything that you're doing, you have the prop making, you have all these great things, I think you could totally share your knowledge about it with that. I think people are very interested in not just seeing you make something, if that's not the way that you can have a setup for it, although that's always cool. I think even just talking about it and explaining what you're doing and what you're into and what you've done and what you've made, your experiences, that's a very unique thing. I haven't seen many people. I've done 160 of these shows. I haven't seen many people come on here with something as cool as what you're doing. You know, so, and you got a good looking book. Your book sounds interesting. I think whatever it is, whatever you're doing, if you go into it being genuinely yourself, doesn't mean you got to be like the greatest entertainer in the world, the smartest person on a subject, whatever it is. You know, maybe your audience size will vary depending upon what it is you're talking about or what you're doing. But be you. You know, I know it sounds really simple and cliche, but I think that's the key for everything. And then you'll be happier with it, too. You'll stick with it longer. And the longer you stick with it, the more that you'll grow. It takes time. I've been doing this for 18 years. I still don't know what the hell I'm doing half the time. I'm like, does that work? Does this work?
Aww.
You know, and then you take stock of it and go, okay, that seemed to work more than this seemed to work. Mm-hmm. And then you also take stock of, I really liked doing that. You know, I didn't really like doing that. You know, and then you do more of what you really like and you do more of what seems to work. Hopefully there's a cross between the two. And then sometimes you're going to have that experience where you're like, I love doing that. And people seem to love it too. And then that's the best feeling in the world. But you have to keep going out there and trying to see what it is. But always lead with what is genuinely of importance and of interest to you, because you'll stick with it longer. It has nothing to do with like a selfishness mentality or anything like that. It just has to do with, if you go about it and you're not interested and you just go, well, this person does this and they get a lot of people that are interested, I'll try to do what they do, even though I don't really want to do that. People will go and they'll see you and they'll go, this person seems uncomfortable. They seem like they'd rather not do that or talk about that or be that way. And then that's not going to get people drawn to you, or worse, people will be drawn to you and that's not you at all. So now you have to keep living the lie.
I had a couple of other prop makers tell me, like, well, you have to do tutorials, you have to do YouTube videos, you have to do this and that, and I was like, well, I'm lazy, but I'm not really into that. I like to write things and then maybe play video games, maybe do a commission sometimes and craft something along the side, but really have every day doing this. I mean, I'm working, so I'm a graphic designer by day and a writer, prop maker, everything else by night. So
everything you're telling me, I'm like, that needs to be there. There's so if you want to even discuss like graphic design on your channel or your social media, if you want to discuss prop making, whatever it is that you're into in a big way that you're genuine about, talk about that. And then that's how you'll grow the audience. The only way you're going to grow an audience for the book is by growing an audience for yourself. And I know it feels like, well, they're not buying me, but yes, they are. They are buying you. They're buying and entrusting you, who you are and what you're doing. And people are interested in that. If they don't, think about how many people on an independent level, not on a big corporate level where they've got the money and the brand and they've been around for forever and you couldn't think of who the hell they are that makes what they make. You know, but you know the brand, you know what they've done. Yeah. They have the time and the money and they've been there for a long time. But on an independent level, think about, do you buy things from people that you hate and don't know and don't like you? Very incredibly rarely, if ever. You know, but there's people you'll be like, hey, I'm really drawn to what they're doing, who they are, what they're about, what they're interested in. I'll take a look at what it is that they do. Now, then if they're interested in that past that point and they go, oh, wow, I like this person. Plus, I like what they're doing. Then now you also have a customer who's interested in what you're doing. And they're going to go, I'm going to buy that, what they're doing. And then if they like it, they'll continue. So it sounds very simple. It's easier said than done. I'm aware of that. It takes time. Yeah. But I think whatever it is that you're doing, always have faith in yourself on that level and keep pushing it. You're going to get there. You've got a lot of great things that you can share with a lot of people. And I think that if you continue to get out there with all of that and push that to the front of here's all the things I like, I'm comfortable with talking about, and I think people would benefit from it too, you're going to have success. But it'll take time. I don't know how long it'll take. Maybe a year, yeah. Maybe 5 years, maybe whatever. Who knows? Maybe a month. Sometimes people just psh, out of nowhere. You know, but keep sticking at it. But always think about how can you be genuine and how can you also then be of service to others. Every single person I ever talk to who is struggling with anything, even at times when I've really struggled, I'm like, am I being of service to people right now? Am I giving them some information that's useful, or am I sharing and commiserating with something, or am I being honest and genuine with what I'm talking about, and am I genuinely excited about it? And if the answers were ever no, I'm like, well, then that's why I'm failing right now. And usually whenever I'm failing, it was because of that. Whenever I'm succeeding, it was because I was already doing that. So even if I took the time to self-assess and say, am I doing that? I was doing that. Anytime I wasn't, I failed. So it's always think about that, and people will be drawn to you. And again, I know it takes time, and sometimes it could be really frustrating because there are going to be days where it feels like you're not, it just doesn't see anything you're doing, just isn't working out. Have faith in yourself, stick to it, because tomorrow it's going to work out. Maybe that's tomorrow or 2 days or a week or whatever it is. Keep sticking at it. And you'll get
there. Oh yeah, I'm not usually not the person who gives up. I mean, I planned 5 books, so that's passion, I think.
Yeah. See, it's incredible. You know what you're accomplishing is great, and there's a lot that people can learn. People in this space, especially graphic design, is a big thing. If you were to talk about graphic design and all of that, okay. Especially if you can show, you know, what you're doing, what works for you, detail your experiences and things like that of what you learned. That's great. That's incredible. That's teaching, to be perfectly honest. That's the best kind of teaching, to say, here was my experience. Here's what I learned from it. And maybe you can learn something from it too. You don't have to be some accredited expert or whatever, you know, but yeah, I think stick with it. You got a bright future ahead of you. We got a couple people here saying some good things as well. Look at that. Andy go, I would buy from Anna. You know, and Boombot says, have you built any props based on your comics?
Yeah, absolutely. As I said, the ghost figurine. Oh, okay, he's missing an arm now, but yeah, this one. And I do have a couple of props. That's from book 3. So yeah, little gadgets and everything. So yeah, I'm always crafting something.
See, Comics for Life says, would you be interested in working for companies like DC and Marvel if you haven't already, or do you prefer creator owned?
You mean as a writer? Because I don't have...
I guess so. Yeah. I guess, do you prefer making your own comics? Or given the opportunity, would you work for Marvel or DC?
I would probably rather have my own comics, because I know you have to know the characters from DC and Marvel well to write them. I know people nowadays don't really...
debatable nowadays, but yeah, you should.
But,
you should.
I'd need to be invested in Superman or, I don't know, anyone else. So I'm not really invested in those. So I'd rather stick to my own things and, leave the other boys to you.
Yeah, there you go.
To the pros.
Citizen Ronan says, this is the second time I've seen Anna interviewed and she's great. She's selling herself too short. Yeah, don't do that. Aww. Yeah. Keep leaning into what makes you want to do what you do. And other people will be gravitating towards that. Cole King says, not sure if you mentioned it, but Double Star is 136 pages. And Cold Gravity is 182 pages. These are huge books. Wow. Yeah. I didn't see that. I don't think you mentioned it, but look at that. These are big.
Yeah. The third book is, I think, 182 as well. Yeah.
Wow. Holy smokes. So there you go. Good point there, Cole.
Yeah, the artist is a busy bee, poor guy.
Man, oh man. How long does it usually take you to craft the story for it? And then how long does it usually take for the art to get done and everything to go to print?
So it's actually overlapping. Everything is overlapping. So basically he's now at the last chapter, inking the last chapter and lettering and everything. He's doing everything. And I finished the script for book four. So, and this will be ready, I think, in March. So he can start in April or June with the next book. So it's really just like overlapping. Yeah.
Wow.
Busy.
Fantastic. He seems like he's pretty fast.
He is, yeah. He's absolutely fast. Sometimes he's surprising me with all the pages he has done. Like, you have done these in what, a week? Oh my God. Are you even sleeping? But I can't communicate with him, so yeah.
Holy cow. Have you ever communicated directly with him?
I did, but it's usually translated with Google or DeepL or ChatGPT, I don't know.
Oh, okay.
But it's cute, like, okay.
That's great.
Yeah.
Let's see. Comics for Life says, how much do you think manga is influential in your work, percentage wise? But I guess you could, if you can't nail down a percentage or anything like that, but how much do you think it is? Is it a big influence?
Do you mean the art itself or the style of the...
I think let's say the overall book, the overall thing that you're making.
It's a huge influence. I had a couple of notes next to my feedback for the artist, and I was like, please don't make it too American looking, make it Asian. Like, ignore the US stuff. And he was like, okay. So yeah, I really want to have my own official manga. So I was like, really, like, this looks too Western.
But you read it like a Western comic, right? Left to right, top to bottom.
Yeah. In Vietnam, they do it as well, so it wasn't, they didn't have to adjust anything. They just had to do it like they always do, yeah.
Very nice. Let's see, Aloise says, I just got here, what does the book look like? Okay, you could go to the website, but I'll go to it right now real quick before we wrap up.
That's one of the books.
And it's very nice. So the website is in the link is in the description of the show. And here is the site. So you have a bunch of different preview pages and whatnot too. You see all the different things available on here. If we go to, let's go to the second book here. You can see some of the art. So here's some of the pages that are colored. I really like the black and white. The color's nice, but I really like the black and white. Yeah, it's very nice stuff. So yeah, check it out. The link is in the description of the show if what you're seeing looks interesting to you. All right. Okay, so we're going to be, the logo is awesome. That's the thing is, I love it, and I get why you're doing it. And I want to see more of what you're doing. I think it's a lot of fun. But yeah. I just hope that it's not, and it might be, in terms of the searchability mm-hmm. factor.
Well, if you Google for the name, you can actually only find my stuff, so... It's okay for now, but yeah, I see where you what you mean, and yeah, I would just have to do some thinking later.
Yeah, and if you listen to my advice or anyone else's, and it sounds like the dumbest thing you ever heard, always feel free not to take that advice.
Okay.
But sometimes you'll hear something and you're like, you know, that sounds like that might make sense. And then look into it, you know. But always, whenever anything comes your way, whether it's feedback, a critique, criticism, even sometimes if it's something that comes your way that's like, wow, that person's incredibly rude, but they kind of had a point. You know, someone could be very nice and there's no point whatsoever to what they're saying. It doesn't, it's not going to work. And then someone could be very rude and you're like, there's a point to what they're saying.
It's like an awakening, like, oh, okay.
Yeah. And either way, no matter what, you know, just what you did, you're like, oh, yeah, I'll take that into consideration. You know, that's nice. But Anna, seriously, it looks good. And believe in yourself with your marketing and whatnot. I want to see you getting out there more. You got really good stuff. You're talented. And you're doing something that I don't see a lot of people doing out there, especially within the indie comic sphere. You know, so own that. Get out there. Tell people about it. Put it out there. Not just your book, but also the other things that you're doing and you're into. I really think it's great.
Thank you. But, I will try and make a list with what I have to do to get there.
I hear you. It's tough, but keep at it. You'll get there.
Yeah.
All right. Everybody, thank you guys so much for watching today. Again, go check out this book. The link is in the description of the show. Before we go, Anna, where can they find you?
You can find me everywhere. If you, you can find me on Instagram, on Twitter X, YouTube, Facebook, everywhere basically.
And you know, what's the name there? The
handle is Folkenstahl. That's my main handle.
So Folkenstahl, just like what you guys see wherever that is on the screen there. Yeah, there. All right. Everybody, thank you guys so much for being here. Again, appreciate your questions and your comments. And Anna, really appreciate your time today. Thank you for being here with me and having this conversation. It means a lot.
Thank you for having me.
No problem whatsoever. All right. Everybody, have a great day, rest of your day, and then a great night, and then an even better tomorrow. I'll see you guys soon. Everybody, take it easy, and be well. See you guys.